everyone. Welcome to our broadcast. This is the Metaphysical Art Gallery, and we are here with Roe LiBretto.
Hi, guys. I'm here. I made it this week. Thanks for having me, Katie. Hi.
Yes, absolutely. I am so excited about your most, recent additions to the Metaphysical Art Gallery, and I'm really excited to show them off tonight. So you want to just jump right in and what do you want?
Yeah, well, so I don't know if you noticed, I was posting some kind of interesting stuff on social media this week. Things like the statement by Confucius, no matter where you go, there you are. And then I said a little something about my painting Applied Science, which is actually on the Metaphysical site, where I said that intuition and intellect must be in balance in order for you to really understand something you experience. And what I was trying to do is to get our viewers into the mindset of what it is like to be creative and all the things that we have to go through as creatives to get to the point where we actually put the paint or the pencil or type up the story or whatever it is that we do. And I think that I know that we all work differently. We all have a different place of starting. Some people will sit down with a blank piece of paper and just draw circles until they see a pattern emerging that they find interesting, and then they'll develop that into a painting. Some people go out in nature and copy the flowers and the mountains and the beautiful skies that they see. And then some of us just see stuff. we try to find a way to get that out there. And I fall in that category of people who see stuff. So what I want folks to understand is that it doesn't always happen the same way. And if you look at my paintings, I think you can actually tell which ones happen which way. Because I think that there's a slight difference in style. My favorite ones are the ones that come as full-blown visions. They just appear to me, and I have no idea what it's about, and I just try to draw them as they are, and then later on I have to go interpret that. And that's pretty much what the artist was. The artist was that kind of a vision.
Oh, wow.
But there's other pieces, like, I'm trying to think if I have one. There's a piece that comes to mind. It's called Ganesha Leads Doubting Thomas Past the Obstacles to Love. That one was, do you remember that one?
Yeah, I do. I love that story. That was a
phrase. That was a sound that I heard, a rhythm that from walking. I was walking to work and I heard this repeated rhythm over and over again. And eventually the words came out. And I understood the words. And then the vision came after the words. It was like once I focused on what the language was, the painting unfolded in front of me. So some things happen like that. In fact, I'm working on three pieces right now that are like that. I woke up one day and I had three puns just go like bang, 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 one after the other in my head. Nobody told me anything. I wasn't trying to think about anything. It just came into my head. And one was... head over eels, okay, as opposed to head over heels, you're head over heels for someone. I'm not saying they're good puns, but they're puns. So I sat down and I did some drawings on that topic. And then another one was brain versus prawn. And Louise, Louise Hamel? I don't know if you know the artist. She says to me the other day, of course, brains over prawn, because prawns don't have any brains to begin with, you know. But the real saying is brains versus brawn.
Oh.
Right?
Yeah.
Which is one of those issues of, brains, brawn, there shouldn't be an issue. It's kind of like intellect and intuition. The two things have to work together in order to make something right. But anyway, so that's one other way in which the imagery comes to me. It comes to me through language. And then I think about the words that I heard and the vision comes up and then I draw from there. Let's see if there's and the other kind, which I think is really apparent, they're more intellectual exercises. So you take a piece like the priestess of Ephesus. Someone came to me with a theme and asked me to make a painting, a bee painting, for the Ghost Wolf Gallery show a few years ago, right? And it was all about bees, and I work with mythology. So I was like, well, how can I tie in the theme of bees with what it is that I do, which is interpreting iconography, right? Because that's what I actually do.
Yeah.
So I had to do the intellectual research for it and make it happen. And then another example of that is most recently, the piece with the butt hands that Morgan that Morgan had suggested, that was someone else's idea, and I painted their idea in my way, right? So if you look at a piece like Idealism, which is the one that Morgan inspired, and you look at a piece like The Priestess of Ephesus, and you compare them with works like Applied Science or The Artist or The Annunciation, you can actually see that there is a even a drawing style that's not quite the same. So I know that there's Applied Science. You see Applied Science there?
Yeah, yeah. Here's Applied Science right here. Yeah, these are...
So you see those, they're very kind of, I want to say goofy shapes. They're all more cartoony than the stuff that is inspired by the intellect.
Oh.
Like, because these things just appear like that, and then I just draw them as they appear. But if it comes from a phrase first, or someone suggests a concept to me, the pieces come out more, I guess they have a more realistic quality to them. And I think everything we have here is all the visions. You have all, I think all these pieces are visions.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you can tell by the style that that's what they are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. So if we go to your website.
Oh, you can probably do a comparison then if you go to the website.
Yeah, let's do that.
And for those who have you never been there before, it's RoeLiBrettoFineArt.com. That's where we're headed. There you go. And if you go into Shop Fine Art Paintings, you'll see everything at once. It'll make it easier for you to do a comparison.
Oh, wow.
So right there, see Fearless Examination of Self?
Yeah.
That was a vision. That was you and I having, remember? You and I having pizza that day. We had lunch together. And that's how I knew I loved you in that moment. I knew who you were and I understood you in that little moment. I was like, I get it. Okay. But if you scroll down to where the soul dorks are, you'll see the priestess is way down there.
Wow.
I'll look if there's any other the intellectual works up top, but no.
Here's this one.
Yeah, see priestess? See how it looks more realistic? Yeah, and I would say that the one with the rose, the illuminated in the current self,
yeah.
I think that was influenced by the concept of trying to represent the virtues, the theological virtues, right? So.
Oh, wow.
So this was Amy Ditto deciding she wanted to have a bee exhibition. Am I going... I'm an iconographer. How can I work with the bee exhibition? And you can see it's more realistic than the other works are.
Yeah, it is.
And then if you go back to the theological virtues, because all these are sold already. If you go to the, there, that one, you could take the one with the rose in it. Theological virtues, same deal. They started with an intellectualization, a concept. I would like to do something representing the theological virtues. And that was because I woke up that morning and I heard that in my head, the three theological virtues are faith, hope, and charity. So I started with that phrase and then I developed these drawings. So they do look much more realistic than the things that happen on their own.
Wow, cool.
So let's take a look at the artist.
All right.
Which is on the Metaphysical Art Gallery website. It's now available as prints through Metaphysical. And I had actually done it, I'm trying to think of when. I think I did it at the beginning of the Trump administration. Because I did it at the same time that I did the Annunciation, and there's characters that cross over from one to the other.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So here's the artist.
There you go. There's the artist. And actually, the Annunciation came first, and the artist came second.
Okay.
But they were both visions. Each was a vision. And they overlapped so closely. See, what happens to me is an image appears to me, and then another image appears, and another image appears. And I realize that I have all the images for one story when the first image comes back, right? It's like a repeating cycle.
Wow.
But what happened to me was, see the little guy with the umbrella?
Yeah.
He didn't go away. He's from the other painting. I saw him in the Annunciation first.
Oh, wow.
So after I painted him as part of the other story, and he still kept coming, I was like, okay, he must belong in another piece. And then I waited for the pictures to come, and they did. And interestingly, this piece was the piece that explained to me, dumbass that I am, what my mission is. And I'm sure that I have spoken about this before. So if we look at, actually, let's take the piece as a whole. When we get to the part that's me, then I'll be able to explain. So I think I can share my screen where I have it already blown up, and I can do point and pointing to the parts. Would that be all right with you?
Yeah.
All right. Can you see me?
Yes.
Okay. So here, let's start here. Even though when I first started this painting, it started with this character, okay, this character appearing to me. When I read the story, I realized that the story starts with these kind of fugitive looking background fish. Now, if you know my work, you know that fish represent emotions. And because these fish are so hidden, they're actually hidden feelings. They represent the unseen feelings of people who are being victimized.
Oh, wow.
And then we have this little guy here with the umbrella. He represents, he's protecting himself and his partners in crime. If you were to cross-reference him here and you saw him in the other painting, you'll see that he has some cronies in the other painting that he's kind of protecting with his umbrella. Here he's got a loot bag. He's got all this money. And the house on his head represents security.
Oh, wow.
Right. So he's all about being grounded and secure for himself and protecting his friends. And if we look over, we can see who his friends are. Here is Lust. And Lust, this character, first appeared in a painting I did called The Seeker and the Grail.
Oh, yeah.
Remember him there?
Yeah.
And that story was all about seeking fulfillment of self through some outside stimulus, like knowing that you're not complete, but not understanding that your incompleteness is because you haven't recognized your deeper self, but looking to fulfill yourself through addictions, you know, like, it could be a drug addiction. It could be television addiction. It could be the addiction of the affections of another person.
Yeah.
Right? So here he is representing Lust, and here's his crony protecting him. Now, this little guy, he appeared all on his own during the series of working on this painting. I had never had him before, but he is the symbol of over-intellectualization. And if I could, I don't know if I can blow this up. Is that possible to blow it up at this point?
If you hit Control Plus.
Control Plus.
Let's
see how far I can blow him up. Maybe not too far. Oh, there he is. There he is. Okay, so let me scroll. Can I scroll? Yeah, there he is. Okay, so you can see him a little bit better. All right. So he has no lips and his teeth are being grit. He can't even speak. And his eyes are sewed shut. If you see the original painting or you can see it in the print, his eyes are sewed shut.
Wow.
And his feet are not on the ground. He's walking on stilts that he uses his hands to keep himself balanced.
Oh,
and that's because he's all wrapped up in his brain. And when people over-intellectualize any kind of a problem, they can't help anybody. They can't help themselves. And they can't help the people if they even wanted to help the people. But some people think that the intellect is far superior to many other ways of learning or many other ways of interacting with people, right? Mm-hmm. So that's this person here. This is that guy. He's above it all, you know, on his stilts. He doesn't really connect in any way to the humanity around him, right? So these guys, they don't see the feelings of those who are victimized. They're incapable of seeing past themselves.
Oh, wow.
And then we come to my favorite guys, the carnivorous pigs. The carnivorous pigs are devouring their young, and they represent people who take advantage of the wealth of the current situation, whether that wealth has to do with environment, right? So they're burning through the environment, they're wasteful people, they're fracking or whatever they're doing. And it's at the expense of their young.
Yeah.
Right? At the expense of the future. They might as well be eating their young. So that's what that's about. And now you know that my fish represent emotions.
Yeah.
And here, this carnivorous pig has a fish on his head. And what I realize that symbolizes is he's in a moment of sudden self-awareness. And when we become aware that our behavior is something that we're not proud of, chances are we get overwhelmed by emotions. I mean, when we truly become aware of it, not when we say, oh, yeah, well, I did that, or when we become defensive because of our behaviors, but when we accept the responsibility of the damage that our behaviors have caused, it's a very emotional effect. And that's where healing begins, from that point. So this pig is in that state where he's overwhelmed with the knowledge of what it is he has done. So his feelings are kind of taken over on him. And you see this little guy down here, this little chicken?
Wow.
He's learning by example.
Yeah, what's going on with that?
Right? He's like, is this what the world is like? Is this the world? Is this the way I have to be in order to exist in the world? So as you know, my little eyeball chicks that appear in, I don't know, any number of paintings, they always represent seekers of truth. And within that category, we can say that children fall within that category, and truth seekers as adults, people who really care about their own personal growth and the growth of others, how their behavior affects others. Those are truth seekers, right?
Yeah.
They want to be better. So in this case, here's a little truth seeker, and he's wondering if this is what he has to become in order to be able to fit into the current world.
Wow.
Now, up here on the cliff, I'll take you out here on the cliff. Out here on the cliff, we have a bystander. You see, she's walking her little healthy, little happy pig pets. And we have a teacher. Now, the bystander sees that there's stuff going on, but they don't really understand the ramifications of what the behavior of all these guys is. They can't really comprehend the damage that it's causing in this world, in this reality, in the reality in which they live, right? So it's the job of the artist. Now let's see if I can shrink the screen again, if I know how to do it. There we go. So it's the job of the artist to make what's going on apparent to bystanders who might not know it. Right? Who might not really think it's affecting them. And in order to do that, the artist, the creator, you know, I say artist because I'm a visual artist, but you know, these people who are writers and dancers and whatever their creative fields are, you have to step outside your personality. You have to step outside your, oh, let's see, your personal priorities and take on this yoke of divine inspiration. You have to allow yourself to become a vehicle that can make injustices apparent to those who don't see them. At least for me as an artist, that's what I try to do. I mean, that's what I work at.
Wow.
Now, in that process, you step aside from self, right? You're shedding your meat suit now. You've got this yoke of divine inspiration. Once you do that, you're in a position where you Kundalini rises within you. It's set loose. Your creative spirit is set loose. You're inspired by your higher self. That's the old eyeball there. There's a higher self up there off the picture plane, shining down, telling you what's the next thing that you have to do. You accept the responsibility of the next thing you have to do, and your creative force is released inside of you and comes out and helps you make the work that you make.
Wow.
So that's why I think that this piece of all the pieces that I make, this is the piece that is my mission statement, the purpose of my work, right?
Wow.
Now, this is not to say that artists who don't have such lofty ideas for their work are not, right? Don't have purpose. They do have purpose. Everybody has purpose, right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You have a purpose to bring joy. You have a purpose to find yourself through your medium. Okay. Everybody has their own purpose, and everybody else has their own way of going around it, getting to it. And I did post a Georgia O'Keeffe quote on social media about that, about not being able to measure, I'm coming off of that now, not being able to measure your failure or your success, but looking at if you are able to make your unknown known, in that way you have succeeded. So I think that through my work, I'm obviously able to see things about myself, but I'm also able to share things that other people will benefit from when they recognize it within them own, their own selves.
Yeah.
So, excuse me. So that's like, that's my heady end.
Ro, I cannot wait for the day that your work is available as a bedside book or a deck of tarot cards that you can interpret, like that sort of thing. You have so many incredible pieces that I just love.
Thanks.
This is up there.
Thanks. Yeah, this one is really important to me. Absolutely is important to me. And that's really why I wanted to make it available through Metaphysical Art Gallery. I wanted other people to be able to have it and to think about what their own personal purposes are and how they're going to use that, how they're going to find the gift within themselves to fulfill their purpose. And whatever, I don't care if you're a freaking accountant, you know, you don't have to be a creative, so to speak, right? Whatever it is that you do, that when you do it, you get in that zone and you know that you do it well. And you know that because you do it well, you're capable of helping other people with it. Then yeah, I don't care if you're a garbage picker, you know, it doesn't matter. It's whatever your purpose is, to take pride in it, to do it the best that you can. And then your example of doing something the best way that you can do it is what will raise other people up as well. So that's my two cents for tonight.
Well, we've had quite a few viewers and comments. We had Jonah Liu in the house and Natasha Stahl. And the Metaphysical Art Gallery was here, Natasha Stahl again. And then we have some Facebook users that I can't see their names, but they were commenting. Somebody said, oh, wow, I feel this so much to this work. And one of them said, Tom Greenbaum said, love your eyeball chicks, seekers of truth.
Yeah, he does. He owns a couple.
Oh,
yeah, he
cool. Does.
He has a little seeker pendant. And yeah, he's a fan.
Oh, Denise Weaver Ross says, I'll help you put a book together, Ro.
Oh, God.
Oh,
that's a huge task. That's such
a
huge task.
I know it's huge, but it'd be so good. I would get one. I would definitely get one.
Ah, thanks. Thanks. Thanks.
And Jonah Liu says, brilliant, my friend. I'm so excited to share this video with everyone.
Thank you. Well, I appreciate you all being out there and all the years that you guys have encouraged me, because, you know, growing up, this stuff was like nutcase material. And it was definitely and it was definitely kind of repressed for a long time. So it's nice to be able to get out here and put it out and understand it and share the meanings with other people. So thanks for making that possible, Katie. I appreciate you.
Oh, absolutely. I love your work, Ro. It's been fantastic. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. And you can find Ro LiBretto on the metaphysicalartgallery.com. You can also go to rolibrettofineart.com and see all of her work.
Thanks for being here, folks.